My name is Geethan. I run this organization, Nibanna. Nibanna means liberated from past conditioning. So we work in areas of helping people to develop themselves in one side. The other side was we work with organizations. So when I was working with organizations, I want to have a different approach rather than just training. That is where I was searching, and fortunately, I met Dr. Bernd Schmid. And then our approach in organizational context took a very different direction. So instead of teaching or instead of conducting training programs, we created a dialogical situation where people were able to understand through learning through their own organizational context. And that was very helpful. And the journey between Bernd and I had been, the distance was not a matter. I was working in India, but connecting with him in Germany, but interacting many times, recording our work. And at many times I wondered how easy solutions were when I was interacting with him. How easy certain things were in the unconscious came to my consciousness effortlessly. Major complex situations, simple solutions were available. So I thought maybe not just me alone having that experience.
Did you change something with him?
No, I didn't. It just became dialogical. So it became, the distance was not a matter. We were able to coordinate well. And at one point, I thought it would be good if Bernd Schmid is in India, and many of you can experience the same thing which I was learning from him. And we also see this as a pedestal or a launch pad to launch this kind of a different approach in organizational development work. So how do we make an initiative? In India, we have Lord Ganesha. We can bring Ganesha, and then we say, we pray him, and then we say we initiate. Yes, that's one way to initiate. Another is to bring the guru who taught that method. And then that's a wonderful idea to have my guru here. Thank you, Bernd, for coming here and being with us and sharing your experience. So thank you. And thank you all for being a part of it. Because whatever effort we made, Bernd could come, but without you, there's no meaning. So thanks for you coming. And when you have come and we are here, Bernd is here, we can make a meaningful learning experience. To Bernd.
Thank you very much, Geethan. Yeah, you did an awful lot of work, and you have been very sustainable in your curiosity and seriousness to learn and to make up your own mind on ideas I offered to you. And we had a very good cooperation over these 3 years, so about 3 years now. So thank you all for coming here. I'm not a very... I'm not very much used to do international training. Yeah, so it's a year ago I did once. But I'm already in the process of retirement. I'm 68 now, and I stopped my teaching in German language since years already. But it was a wonderful and enriching the contact with Geethan. So that I thought I should come here and share what we developed in Germany, and hopefully you can make any use of that. So I also apologize that my English is limited, but it's worse in UK. I guess you we can talk to each other more easily here. So one of the overall focuses here is building up culture, learning culture, organizational culture, professional culture. Culture means the way people to relate to each other and to the subjects they are dealing with. And it's very complex, as you certainly know. And this is why one of my slogans, you will see a chart to that later, is if you want to go fast, go slowly and invest first into culture. And we will have now a 3-day workshop, and it should be personally meaningful. And this is why we have to invite your soul and to help you to connect to each other, because we are not, we have a network of souls here, and these souls should have a chance to talk to each other beyond conventional talking. And this is why we will soon start with a short encounter exercise before we go to the content. So I will soon introduce a short encounter exercise, and I will ask you after a short guided imagery to talk to each other, to share some moments. We will not make a big round, it would take us 2 hours. But you will have one or two chances to talk to other people, so that you have a starting point of getting in contact. After that, I will outline the program for these 3 days, so that you get an idea what we are doing. And we have a part of the program I consider as a must, and we have a part of the program, these are the options, and we have to talk to each other what matters to you, really. And then we will start with the first chapter of our meeting. Let me say something to the structure here. This, I don't know if the right word, podium, but here is not because I wanted to be above you. It's in case we do conversation and some demonstration, then we sit. And if we would sit down there, you would, at least people in the back cannot watch, so then we will sit here. But they planned, as you may have noticed when you came in, they have planned to put me up here. But that's not the attitude of equal eye-level communication I'm standing for, so I go down. Do you understand me? Is my English good enough, and is it loud enough? Okay. So, what you see here is my institute in Germany. On the left, it's one of the buildings. On the left, this is a seminar house, and on the right, the upper part is our private house, and the lower part is where the employees partly live. Because our trainers come from long distance, and as long as we have the workshops, they live with us. So we have a culture of very close connection between private life and professional and organizational life. And this is the lower part. And we have a garden back, and we have 2 back office houses, and we have 2 guest houses in the other directions. But this is to give you a smell for the atmosphere we are working here. This is it's close to Heidelberg, which is a famous city, and Mannheim. It's close to SAP. Many of you may know this international IT company, which is in the next, it's 5 kilometers from us. It's close to BASF in Ludwigshafen. But it's a bitter side, and this is a good point for retiring, thinking, learning, and not be in the midst of the hurry, of the everyday hurry. So soon I will do a little guided imagery exercise with you to invite what wants to come up from your background, but it's only for you dialoguing with it, then later you decide what you communicate to other people, so that you get in a good dialogue with yourself, with the different parts of your personality. So, and these are the four questions I will offer you. You can be oriented when you sit together in groups of three, but I will do a guided imagery first then. I want to answer the question for myself now. I already said something. Who is talking? I used to be a psychotherapist for many years. I'm a transactional analyst. I studied Gestalt therapy, Jungian psychotherapy, systemic family psychotherapy, and some others. And after many years, also doing training psychotherapists, somehow always to repair seemed too limited to me. And I also had studied economics, and so I was very much interested to bring all that knowledge back into society, into economy, and may help to change cultures there so that we do not need so much psychotherapy. And since 25 years now, I'm more and more specialized in the organizational field, and I totally gave up my clinical identity. From my attitude, I'm still a psychotherapist. At least I care for the soul of people, although we are doing work on performance and business and organization. But in the end, it's the humans count. For whom is economy, if not for humans? Married, we had two children. One died. My daughter, who is left, is 28 now. She is a psychologist. I'm together with my wife now 47 years, and we hope we can continue that. We are a training institute, so this is important for you to know that. Also, I've been for many, many years a consultant in the organization. Now we are specialized in trained specialists, coaches, organizational developers, leaders, managers, HR specialists, all people who do developmental work with individuals and organizations in the organizational field. In the last 12, 15 years, we have trained about 4,000 professionals. Average age is 40. So these are people already professionally successful, but who want to rearrange their identities, their orientation in life. And from the major companies in Germany, which are in the DAX, this is a stock, German stock indexed, we have 90% as customers. So we are, over the years, these companies understood that it's necessary to send again and again more specialists to the same place, so that they bring the same culture back, so that they can connect to each other within the same frame of reference within the organization. Years before, they were used to send their specialists to anywhere, and they came back, and it brought a big confusion within the organization, because the clash of cultures was not handling. They could not handle that. So I'm talking as a teacher for professionals, as an organizer of learning culture for professionals, and I'm talking, we have now about 20 teachers are regularly working with us in our training programs. I, for myself, as I told you, I stopped doing training about 5 years ago. I sometimes visit the groups. I do consulting so that they can get a feeling of what is the spirit of the founder. But all the rest are doing my teachers at the Institute. We have German programs. We are in the beginning and we would like to do more of that international programs. This is one of the reasons I came here. But I'm not here to gain business. We are good in business, and for myself, I've earned enough money. I stopped with that. I've built up a foundation, and the profit of my company is going into a foundation which is doing pro bono work, which is giving pro bono our knowledge to organizations and people who are doing pro bono work. And this is a challenge. It's not easy. But this is my situation, and I decided to retire more next year when I will become 70. So my dream is, after having breakfast and reading the newspaper every day, I can decide what to do this day and don't have an agenda I'm responsible for. You might not understand this. No, okay. So I came here because Geethan invited me, and it was quite a natural flow, a result coming out of our cooperation, mostly over Skype, but we also met in Italy for 3 days to have a very small internal workshop with each other, working together, talking hours and hours and doing supervision and theoretical discussions. And this was very much enriching, so we continued, and this is why I'm here. And I hope to share with you what I've learned so far in these 40 years of being a professional in that field. Moments of flow I'm a developer. This is my first identity. We do an experiment, and while we try to understand some things that we did not understand before, suddenly ideas come up, and approaches how we can proceed, and concepts how we can map what we experience. And I wrote a lot of this down, and this is why I've brought out more than a dozen books. But they came out of practical experimenting. And this is why the concepts are made in a way, I will explain that more later, that they are quite simple, that they come up to your mind while you are doing practical work. A theory that you have to draw back and read a book and think about, and then maybe it comes to your mind when you are practically doing something, it's not my way to deal with concepts. So, what do I ask myself quite often? The first question, will we survive when we go on the way we do on our planet? And the second question is, what can my profession contribute that the chances become better? And the older I get, the more I have the question, for what should I invest my energy, my life energy? When I was in California 35 or 40 years ago, I lived with a hippie. It was the time, 1968 and later, we lived with a hippie. And he had learned something already, what I slowly learned. Whenever we discussed with him what we should do today, and we made an offer, he thought about it, and most of the times he said, oh no, life is too short for that. So several times a day, I asked myself, is this short life is it worth that I use this short life for doing that? And this gives me a good criterion. But I'm not always doing essential things. Nobody does. Very often I do just so superficial things. So these are some of my answers to the four questions. You will give answers later too. So one of my, I now go to the, because it's about learning culture. If it's okay for you when I do a lot of meta comments, tell you why I do what I do, because I think learning is how to do it and why do it in this way and what's the difference between this or another way is most important. Not just learning something that is good and then using it habitually, but we always hope that you understand the logic behind that you can do it in your way, where you have to create something. So, where do we go? First, about groups. When we, Geethan told me we have roughly spoken three groups here. One are entrepreneurs. Who would call himself to be an entrepreneur? Would you please raise your hand? Okay. And the others are managers or leaders within organizations. Who is that, please? Oh, that's a majority. And we have some leading people from educational organizations. Oh, okay, this is also a big group. If we break into groups of three later, please make sure that you mix up in this way. So the groups go to each to a corner of the room, and then you choose one of the other groups. So we do something a bit that you do not talk to those you always talk, but you talk to people with different perspectives. And this is one of the major exercises in the how we are doing culture, is dialoguing with people with different perspectives and learn to understand and building up a shared reality. Let me think about, maybe we should do that first, build the groups of three, and while you are sitting in the groups of three, then I do the guided imagery, because afterwards you are still in the mood of the imagery, you're still in contact with the images, and we do not have to interfere with an organizational procedure in between. So, can we please have the entrepreneurs here and the managers over there and the people from educational organizations there? Please stand up and move in this corner. Are you available just to get commands? Systemic does not mean no commands. So managers over there, entrepreneurs here, and educational organization people here, please. So, and now build up groups of three, sitting together somewhere in the room, rearrange the chairs and find somebody probably from another group and somebody you don't know. Don't talk to your colleague you came with. And find two partners and sit down somewhere, and then I do the guided imagery. Please move. And sit down somewhere in groups of three. So one of my teachers was Milton Erickson. Milton Erickson he died in 1980, I believe. at old age. He was a handicapped man, and he was a genius as a hypnotherapist. And I had the fortune to have a 1 week training with him, and although it was only 1 week, it influenced my whole professional life. And he invited me to come back, but unfortunately, when death came to his house, he did not have an hypnotic technique to keep him away, so he died, and I couldn't meet him again. I'm not sure whether this is good or bad, because Milton Erickson was a person who always believed in the creative resources within you, and it's enough to invite you into search and into dialoguing. And so all the things I might have wanted to learn from him in a classical way, I couldn't learn. But so many seeds have been in me, and I made something of my own out of these seeds, and I'm very thankful to him. And what I also learned from him is that learning needs to invite not only the conscious mind, learning also may be very fruitful if you invite all your unconscious part to have an assembly within you. And he was convinced that the major decisions in life are made unconsciously. So, but unconscious does not mean wise. Unconscious, the unconscious mind also needs dialogue. And this is why he invited us to dialogue between conscious mind and unconscious mind. And the way he invited us to be open for that this kind of dialogue happens is during a trance induction or guided imagery, or you know, it may possibly know it more from kind of meditation. You are, I'm sure you are familiar with these things. So I invite you now to direct the attention to yourself. You don't need to write down anything during the guided imagery. You will get all the tapes, have access to all the tapes, so nothing, if you want to listen to something or look at something later, it will be available for you. So, yeah, some of you already close eyes, take deep breaths. And what I also learned from Milton Erickson is that there is no one trance. Everybody, trance and concentration to inner essential processes is as unique for everybody and different than any other path of life. So I only can invite you to meet your style. And one way to do is to go down with your voice, to slow down a bit. And the life outside there is safe. It will be there when you come back, and it's loud and noisy and lively. And it's good that it's there. But you don't have to care about it now. You can direct your attention to yourself. And many do that by watching their breath. And you may notice that you already have changed your breath a bit. And you might hear the ventilator. And it's okay to sit comfortably. And it's not necessary to reach a kind of holy attitude. I learned from Milton Erickson that if you are disturbed in some way, doesn't matter. Then you get out, go out for a time And then you go in. It's even used as a deepening technique to switch back and forth. And it's okay to close your eyes, and it's also okay to keep them open. It's important what counts for you. And you might hear again the ventilation. Also, it's technical. It also has a quiet, sustainable sound. If you were a bird, you could use it as a wind machine and be carried up into the sky. This is one of the images you can use, that your mind feels free to move, and that your attention feels free to look for whatever is interesting for you. Some people go into that state of mind during car driving. Everything they do is automatic, and their mind is free to go with your pictures and your movies. Or you can do it walking along the seaside, hearing the waves, and feeling the warm, comfortable wind at your skin. And now I invite you to let come up some situations where you usually introduce yourself, and you can watch yourself in that situations from outside and observe how you usually introduce yourself. It's not always the same, but maybe you have a favorite way to introduce yourself. And it's interesting to consider whom, what part of yourself you are introducing then. And what kind of offer you are making to the other person. And how do they usually react to your way to introduce yourself? And you will soon have an opportunity to introduce yourself again to two other people who are sitting around you. And you might observe yourself how you do it, and you might even want to experiment with doing it a bit differently. So I announced to lead your attention a bit to your professional life, and the first focus is, how did I come here to this workshop? Do you remember what happened that you somehow decided or were motivated to come here? Do you remember your first reaction to that? And if there was a recommendation, you have any idea why you have been given that recommendation? What are the ideas behind? Did you agree to that, or did you have questions? Sometimes it's good to understand what have been the preliminary points of a situation, to understand the situation. As a second point, I want to direct your attention to moments in your professional life where you feel really to be yourself. They often call it flow. Everything falls into place. It's the right situation. You are the right person. And it makes a lot of sense to you without thinking about. Do such situations come to your mind? You might go into that for a moment and feel a bit of that flow. And your unconscious mind will know how it works somehow to get in contact with that flow here in that workshop. And as all of us know, there are not only easygoing situations in professional life. Everybody also has points where she feels somehow unease, having a lot of questions, maybe not being able to say, to pronounce these questions, but feeling the questions. Sometimes it's very subtle, but it might grow over time. And maybe you grasp somehow questions that are important for you. So I don't know whether you got in contact with the focused issues I offered you, but you might just for a moment go back and remember what have been the situations you experienced in the last 20 minutes, 15 minutes, and your conscious mind may understand enough that you can decide to talk about or not if you want a bit later. But it's okay to remember and stay in contact somehow. And somehow staying in contact, you slowly can change your state of mind and coming back more to the everyday attention, functioning. And as everybody has its own way, his own way to go into trance, everybody has her own way to come back. Some do it quickly, some do it more slowly. It's good to do it in a way that you stay in contact. A bit stay in contact and come back. And there are also technical moves you can use to come back, for example, counting from 10 to 1 and by what we call analog marking, raising your voice while you do that. So it's 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 4, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And now it's time to come back and reorient yourself here in the room and become aware of the partners, the two other partners you sit with. Take your time a bit to be aware of yourself, be aware of the others. Oh, everybody seems to be back. Welcome. So, for each of you, we have 5 minutes. So just, you can tell the others what your answers are to these 4 questions. And if you want to report a bit about your experience right now with the guided imagery, it's okay too. Please keep the time. Otherwise it gets narrower for those who are last. In 5 minutes, I give you a sign that you know when to change. So, find your own way in each group, who will start, and the others just, they don't have to say something intelligent, they just can listen and watch what makes it in their mind while they are listening. Yeah, please start. From outside it looked quite lively and related. How was it for you?
Yes.
Yeah. Was that okay?
Yes.
Any complaints?
It's too cold. It's too cold.
Too cold. this complaint is for you, Geethan. I don't know how to handle that. Okay. So usually I do not do a lot of gathering afterwards because I experience it very often just as repeating something that is not yet as essential as it was when it was first time. But if somebody wants to say something, certainly the space is open for that. Three, two, one, zero. Okay. Then I will give you an overview on the contents of the 3 days of the options for the contents. I have 7 main topics. What I would like very much to do here. And these are just 7, and I have some options. And this depends on how we want to use the time, whether we do more experiential or I just give you an overview. Altogether, let me say, in terms of learning culture, I only can give you a taste of what we are doing and an overview on the content level. At our institute, a program that is covering most of what I give you an overview of is 2 years. This means 12 times 3 days. That's the usual training amount we have on that. And people from companies do that. 20 years ago, they went from workshop to workshop, 2 years programs, that was, they believed it's too much, but meanwhile they learned if they really want to have a sustainable development and also a group and collegial exchange culture, it needs more. At least these people who are convinced of that come to us and they are enough so can really make our living off it. So in our workshops at home, we do much more experiential work and training of counseling techniques and teaching each other and interviewing each other. We can't do that here a lot. We can give an example if you are interested in. So the way I do this three-day workshop is not representative of a three-day workshop at our institute. That's, I wanted to let you know to prevent that you think, oh, he's talking about learning culture and dialogue culture, but he's lecturing all the time. So one of the perspectives is systemic approach. Some of you may be very familiar with the systemic approach. Some may not. I have to go through some of the major perspectives, what systemic means. In our country, systemic since about 10, 15 years is a word that indicates quality. And so everybody labels everything systemic or holistic. But for me, it's a very specific notion, and I will go through some of the perspectives of that. And the second perspective I call sharing reality and learning. This has to do with our basic attitude that organizational change as well as personal change is nothing that can be designed outside and then imposed on somebody. It's something you have to have a lot of ideas how to design, but which ideas are valuable you find out when you are in direct contact, and in the end the person must take over to design his or her own life and his or her own organizational culture. But when there are many people involved, we have many ideas about that culture. How can we get together? And when I was asked yesterday by the journalist, he asked me, what was your first experience with India? Because I'm first time in India, so that's my third day. And what was intriguing me most is the capacity to be integrative here. And the world, I think, could learn a lot of it. And when a colleague of mine, who is a professor for brain research and author of many books, he asked me 3 years ago, Bernd, what do you think, what is the main issue for the next decade? And spontaneously I said, integration. We need to learn to shape our contributions to the world in a way that they can be integrated, because we are disintegrating. Many of good things do not come into performance because they are not, we are not able to integrate them into a design that is livable. So we have a lot of concepts and ideas how to strengthen sharing realities that people and organizations can integrate the many aspects of life and of economy and of management. The third point is leadership and performance. In our country, it's a huge fashion, maybe it's here as well. They are now saying, oh, the old hierarchical leadership is old aged. We are now horizontal and everybody can lead. And even we don't need any leadership because everybody's creative. I think I have a sentence, if you fall on the other side from the horse, it's also not written. So it's a polarizing thing. So we have some integrative ideas how we could look at leadership differently today and how we can integrate what is valuable already. And it certainly has to do with performance, because in companies we have to perform, otherwise we will not survive. And a fourth perspective is responsibility and team. Responsibility Ti, if you take the word directly, it means respond ability, be able to respond. And this is our definition of responsibility. And you can understand an organization as a system of responsibilities. And from that you can think about what are the questions that need an answer. And how can you organize to find out who has to give which kind of answers to these questions? And do we have ready-made answers, or do we need to develop new answers? And how can we discuss this amongst each other, how we can do that? So a system, a culture of responsibility. And I guess it's even the case in this country, it's the case in Germany, that very often responsibility is low or confused. And for a long time, it's not cultured enough, and then somehow a disaster happens, like in Volkswagen we have now. The fifth perspective is organizational coaching. I'm a coach, and from my psychotherapeutical tradition, coaching means understanding a human individual in the world of profession. And this is an important part of it. But a person that is in a position and a role in an organization, we need to shift a bit the perspectives. Coaching then has much more to integrate an understanding of the logic of the organization to understand how to be a consultant for that person. And if it's not only one person, but a system of persons, you have to shift again to really understand what the purpose and the logic and the culture of an organization is, and what you as a coach can do to help there. And this is something different and more than psychotherapy within a frame of reference of organizations. And so we have if you are trained as a social-oriented, person-oriented consultant, at least we have developed a lot of habits that are much individually oriented. And it's not easy really to open up all the perspectives that are really important to organizations. And I want to discuss this with you under the term organizational coaching. And this is coming very close. And when I was young, I was a group dynamic person, and I had to do with organizational development, organizations dynamics, and I studied economy as well, not only psychology. And at that time, and then I went to the clinical field and to the human, and I'm on my way back integrating everything I've learned on that way. And organizational development very often is seen very technically. So McKinsey is coming, looking from outside, making a decide how development might be good, and then giving the design to them and say, good luck. And there's a new school, a new movement in the United States and in Canada, Jarvis Boucher and colleagues, and they call it dialogic organization development, saying you cannot impose it from outside. You have to come to a dialogue with those who are responsible. You can use every concept you have from outside, but you include them only if they have any worth dialogue. So this dialogue, organization development, and organizational coaching comes very close together. And this is why we also founded an international network that is studying a lot of connection of these two branches growing together. And the seventh point is organizational culture and maturity. Culture is what people learned to feel, to experience, to do, to act, and how they give them each other clues to invite specific reactions. And this is a complex system. We usually are not aware of it, how it functions. So, but without changing culture, you cannot change an organization. Organizational development has always to do, when it wants to be successful, with change of organizational culture. And this has different perspectives, for example, learning culture, leadership culture, responsibility culture. And the second term that is written here is maturity. As a training institute, we train professionals. They come in with their cases on the challenges they have in the sphere of organizational development. And because they've paid money and they come to us, they hope that within a very short time they learn to be an expert, and the programs they are trying to do is then manageable. But the more an organization is not used to really learn how to do organizational development, the more they have illusions on what can be reached. And this is very often why this person is under pressure to serve these illusions. And then this can go to the training group. Everybody says, oh, this person might not understand enough his or her own role and might not understand enough the maturity of the organization. And then we should design a learning design of an hour to fix all that. That's impossible. So we learned before going into a supervision or going into a workshop design on this case, first to find out what we believe, what we can reach for the person, considering where the person is in its professional growth, and related to the maturity of the organization the person wants to act in. And after clarification of that, then designing what we can do in a learning design. And so we have some experience on that, and I wanted to share that experience with you. These are the seven major points from the perspective entrepreneurship, organization, professional development. I want to share with you, and I hope you accept that we do all these 7 points during these 3 days. I also hope then to have a videotape, and this is free on our website, that you and others can at any time use that source for your own benefit. I will say later something about our website. There's a lot of material already. Everything is free. These are the 7 musts, I hope. And we have some topics we can choose from. One is personality, because if we take serious our view on organizations, then we have to rearrange for doing work with organizations our understanding of personality and personal work. Personal work usually cannot mean working with childhood experiences or biography. But what then can be personal work? And then you come to the limits of the psychologist's tradition. And we have developed some ways to do personal work for non-psychologists, because the question of the right personality to deal with the organizational issues is not only for psychologists, and I hope you don't need always the psychology to deal with that important issue. So we thought about what kind of concept can we have, what kind of approaches can we have, that each of you, whether you are psychologically drained or interested, really can use to understand the human acting. And the second point is narrative approach. We already started this morning with the guided imagery. But I've also developed some specific approaches working with inner images that are behind professional identity. Because everybody has sources behind. They must not be childhood resources, but there are images of the soul behind, something that intrigues my soul. And if my soul is not caught, it will not contribute to my professional role. And so I've developed, if I'm not sure what my soul wants with me, what is valuable to my soul, because I'm not used to dialogue. So I've developed procedures working with inner images to pursue this dialogue. This is concerning the person and the development of professional life, career. And the second branch of the same idea is the matching between my culture and the culture of the organization I'm working for. Do we fit to each other? Or did we once fit and the matching is fading? In what dimension is it fading? Can it be made alive again? Or should we separate? And I guess because organizations are always developing in their context and people are always developing their context, the question of is there still matching, a fruitful matching, is important, but it's difficult to talk about that in logical terms. And this is why we need a dialogues, metaphorical dialogues with inner images to understand whether we are, how we move together or apart from each other. And I've developed ideas how we can do that technically. If we do not come through all these things, these are nice to have perspectives are already on our website, because I've taught these things already in the international framework, and you can have all the exercises I've developed. You can have examples for the exercise designs and lectures with the charts around it, and look at the video. So it's there. You don't have to be scared that if you're interested, oh, but we might not manage it to make it here. So the fourth point, and this is these fourth and fifth point are short points. We are developing an international network for organization development and coaching, INOC. And we had an international meeting last year in Germany, and we will have one next year. Geethan and his colleague will come there, and we will have probably even Ed Schein. I don't know whether you know him here. He's one of the grand old men of organizational development in the United States. But he's old, and we are not sure whether he will make it. But the idea is of this international network that specific on the connection point between organizational coaching and organization development, we need to bring that together. And we need, and we invite international dialogue on that, because in many countries it's not yet there, or there are, some things are there, but we should put it together. And the last point is, if you are interested, I say some words about the idea of my foundation. And there's also a global movement of pro bono work that is mainly brought forward by a US-American foundation that is called Taproot. Taproot. Taproot Foundation in the United States. But it's global. I've been on a global meeting in January, and there are also people there from Asia and from all over the world. And it was very interesting to me how different the traditions in pro bono work are in the world. In the Western world, we have so many people who want to do pro bono work, and it's not yet organized enough. It seemed to me that in Asia, it's more a new idea. It's not a tradition to do pro bono work as an organizational professional or as a company. So these are the points. This is the overview. Any questions and comments? Is this what you expected or hoped to find here, or is it somehow opposed or different from what you thought you what you will find here? Okay.
Both these options, are you giving us to call the play, or do you want us to choose the options?
Pardon?
These play options.
I'm not sure. The first seven, yes. And then we have to discuss on the way.
If time permits, we'll have it.
Pardon?
If time permits, we'll have it. Is that so?
I do not.
Time permits.
Yes, certainly. Yeah. So, we have only 3 days, but that's how it is. I'm trying to make it crisp. So so how we do it is presentation like I did now, and if I find somebody who wants to do a learning conversation with me about an organizational issue, we can do a demonstration on how we dialogue on that, how these concepts and ideas work in the direct contact with somebody who has an issue, and it's maybe from time to time a guided imagery, as you had already, and doing some sharing. And maybe we have to decide later, we can also do an exercise on this inner images. But exercises on inner images usually cost, and we have to decide whether we should do it or not. No? So, and the video, I wanted I'm not aware whether Geethan wrote that already in the invitation. We are doing a video of all that here. So this implies that those who act here and be on the tape agree that it can be on our website afterwards. Is that okay?
It's okay.
Okay, and if you don't want to have something published, just don't tell it. That's real life. Okay. And we can promise you that afterwards you can have all the materials, you will have all the charts, and you will have the videos, and you will have the papers I wrote on that around that in English, free available. We even have a system that you can, we call that click to transfer. If you go through the charts and you think, oh, this, I want to use it, we have a button, click to transfer, and then you can take the charts into your frame of charts. And there's only a small sign that is shared, how is it called?
Creative Commons, so we share it with everybody, you just have to
refer
to the original author.
But we invest a lot into preparing our material in a way that you can easily use it for yourself to spread it. And it's everything is free, no charge. So this will be the program and the next point, I guess after a break, will be then on systemic approach.